church. We are redeemed and chosen, trusting in the God of love, the God of hope, the God of atonement. We are church. We believe in one way, one truth, one life. Devoted, eyes fixed on the prize, devoted to Christ. We are church. We put God first. We are like-minded people created in Christ for good works, made in the image of greatness, made to reflect the greatest love ever known. We are church, the light in the dark, the hope to the hopeless, a brand new start, peace for the broken heart, a love that has open arms. We are church. Not four walls, we are a body of believers following the call to know we are forgiven, the call to love without condition, the call to trust without division. Our church, a community with open doors, serving the poor, living for more. We are broken people with a united cause, an unbroken love in a divided society, proclaiming Jesus is Lord. This is what we do. We don't judge, we don't hold a grudge. We are not perfect, but we aspire to love.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Connection Point this morning. We had another successful servicing weekend this weekend with Connection Point. Friday, we did our Salvation Army. We fed 100 people some really good food. Yesterday, we had our Trail of Treats. We treated a lot of kids yesterday, and y'all had some really cute tables and whatnot. Y'all did very good. So I want to thank y'all for all the participation, all the donations. Y'all are making servicing successful, and that's exactly what we want to do. So thank y'all again. If y'all will please, let's stand and begin to worship this morning.
To the Lord of heaven and earth. Welcome to Connection Point. God's really blessed us with some beautiful weather today for the fish and the ducks and the food plots. So I'm going to talk about, you know, Friday I was going to go deer hunting and do a little meditating on what I was going to say for the welcome, but something happened. So now I have something different to talk about. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. So I went out for a little quick afternoon deer hunt and come out to this tree, and the Holy Spirit's telling me, hey, don't climb that tree. And I was like, hey, it's right there by this scrape where I want to hunt, and this is where I'm going to go, and it'll be fine. So I climbed the tree, no issues, up to about 20 foot, and I got up on top of my stick, and I'm looking around, and all of a sudden, My hunting stick just evacuated. It left and fell to the ground. I'm sitting there hanging. Dumb decision. I grabbed hold of my rope trying to hold myself and slid down it about 3 foot. And I said that to say this. You know, we can read God's word and it tells us what to do. And God gave us the Holy Spirit for situations like that to say, hey, dummy, don't do that. And, you know, had I followed the Holy Spirit's urge there and went and picked a different tree, I wouldn't have anything to talk about this morning. So with that, let's pray. Lord, just thank you for this day and this opportunity to be here. Just ask that you would guide us and direct us as you would have us to go. We thank you for Jesus dying on the cross for our sins, and we thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit to keep us from doing dumb stuff like what I did. Pray that you be with Chad as he brings the message and carry us safely throughout our day. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'm glad you're still here, Sam, to give us the message. Everyone, please stand and let's continue to worship.
Tender whisper of love in the day. It's who I am.
Chapel where you hear the pastor preach, the school gym where you attended youth group, the place you go on Sundays, maybe even a service you watch online. Church is all these things, but so much more. It's not simply a building. It's a body, the body of Christ made up of diverse members who share a single faith. We all struggle, but we all believe. We all go through trials, but we have hope that Christ will return to his body, his bride, his people. Amidst loneliness and isolation, the church is a beacon of hope, a reminder of our need for God and for each other. When we take time each week to worship, we join ourselves to believers throughout the world and throughout the ages, to all who are members of Christ's body, the church.
You ever heard of the Headless Horseman? Anybody heard of the Headless Horseman? You know, he made his debut way back 1820 in a short story by a fellow named Washington Irving. And you've probably heard of the story called The Legend of Sleepy Hollow. And the main character is this kind of lean, really superstitious schoolmaster named Ichabod Crane. And one night, he's just having a really bad night. He gets rejected by his would-be girlfriend, and he's riding home all dejected through an eerie wood, and suddenly he's confronted by this cloaked rider. And he notices that this rider's head is not on his shoulders. In fact, it looks like it's hanging from his saddle. And so he starts fleeing on his rented horse for his life to try to get away. And he almost does, but then Ichabod gets knocked off his horse as this headless horseman throws this, what seems to be his head, at him and knocks him off, and he's never seen from again. In fact, the next day when they investigated, all they found was Ichabod's abandoned hat and a busted pumpkin there on the road. Yes, what a great spooky story. Something kind of scary about a body without a head, isn't there? Body tries to function without a head, it's a scary situation. And of course, the Headless Horseman is just a fictional character from many years ago. But there's something even more scary, and that's when the church tries to function without a head. We are a headless body, if you will, if Jesus isn't the one directing us. And I'm telling you right now, that's the stuff of nightmares right there. Try to have a church without Jesus at the head. You see, we've been talking about this for a little while as we talked about the church being referred to as the body of Christ, the functioning body, one unit made up of all these different parts. And we said, you know, as the body of Jesus, we're his hands and feet in the world. We love practically and functionally, but as Jesus would do. We do what Jesus would do if he were here in his body. And most importantly, we learn that he is our head. He directs our path. He's the one that leads. He calls the shots. He sets our mission, and he gives us a leadership to complete it for him. So a church without a head is not really a church at all, is it? We become a club, an organization, an institution, goes through the motions, but a headless church, man, that's scary. And we never want to be that. But on the other side of that coin, a church that submits to Christ as its true head and follows his leadership as best they can, we discover we can do some incredible things because we are part of the body of Christ. Last couple of weeks, we talked about unity and how we are all on the same team, all one. We talked about diversity and how we're all very different and all of our different roles come together. One body, many parts, one body. But when we all work together, we can accomplish the work that Jesus has given us to do. And so this morning, we're going to finish out this series and we spend just a little bit more time talking about that work. What is it the body of Christ should be doing. If we are the body of Christ here in Brooklyn, Arkansas, what should we be up to? What's the most important things we can accomplish as the church? And so we're going to start off over in 1 Corinthians. This time we're going to flip over to chapter 13. We've been in 12, but we're flipping over to 13 as we talk about the function of the church. We're going to be looking at three areas this morning: our motivation, our methods, and our mission as a church that follows Jesus. Now, for us to understand, let me get a running start at this morning. Let me remind you, as we rewind a little bit, of what we said last week. We talked about our diversity and how God brings all these different people. And we talked about how Paul talked about all these spiritual gifts that we've been given, gifts that were presented to the members of the church. We talked about prophets and teachers and people serving and encouraging and giving and showing mercy and having faith and helping others and shepherding God's people and displaying wisdom and speaking different languages. And we just said that just on and on, that God gives all these people all these gifts, brings them together to be the church, to fulfill their role in the body of Christ. But then at the very end of chapter 12, Paul says something very interesting, something we do not want to overlook. The very last thing he says in that chapter is, "Yet I will show you the most excellent way." He says, you got all these people and all these gifts that make all these parts that come together to form this body and do all these different things, but I'm going to show you what makes all these different gifts incredible. I'm going to show you what makes all of this work together. I'm going to show you the most excellent way. And then chapter 13 begins to describe what motivates us as a church. What drives us to cook hamburger patties and mashed potatoes? What drives us to decorate booths and pass out candy? What drives us to do the things we do? The system that brings about the results that Jesus wants. There is a motivation to using our gifts. There is a motivation to successfully functioning as the body of Christ. There's a motivation to being the church that Jesus wants us to be. So what is that most excellent way? Paul says it's the way of love. In fact, he says, as he lists all these gifts, he says, but there's one thing that makes that work, and that is our love. Let me read what he said, and then we'll talk about it in just a minute. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1. Remember now, he just listed these same gifts, and then he says, if I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and I have faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I'm nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give my body over to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Make no mistake, as Paul lists out the gifts that we've been given and the roles that we play, he stops and says, there is a motivation that makes this happen. There is a motivation by which we must fill our individual roles, and it is love. In fact, he says love is absolutely indispensable. We cannot do it without it. Paul says that as a church, we could have the most gifted speaker you've ever heard. We could have the hardest working servants who've ever sweated. We could have the most generous givers that ever earned a dime. But if we are not motivated by love, we will never be effective for Jesus. If we're not motivated by love, we will never be effective for Jesus. You see, the most important part of your gift is not what your gift is, but why you use it. Why do you serve? Why do you speak? Why do you stack chairs and unstack chairs and restack chairs? It's our love. Love for God. Love for one another. Love for those who are outsiders and not part of the faith. I mean, I was thinking about this week. Just this week. You know, the ladies that got up here, our singers got up here, did an awesome job this morning. I worshiped this morning. But you know, this week, they selected songs. They practiced. They came here this morning early so they could be ready to lead us in worship. And there are many things that could motivate that, right? I mean, they could just like singing. They could just like standing in front of people. But here's what I want you to know. The only motivation that's going to make a difference for the body of Christ is if they drew in it because they love God, because they love Jesus, and they want to worship him and lift him up. You see, love's what makes it effective. Last week, our small group leaders came together on Sunday night and then again on Wednesday night. They'd read, they'd studied, they'd prayed, they prepared to lead their groups. But you know, we could think of, well, why would they do that? Well, I mean, sure, they could do that. Maybe they just like hanging out with their friends. Maybe they just like being in leadership. But you know what? It's because of their love for the brothers and sisters. Their love to see them learn and grow. Their love to see them get closer together. They love one another. They love you. And so that's why they work and prepare and pray and invite. Is that making sense? It's the love that makes the difference. We fed hungry people Friday night. And to do that, people had to donate and give and cook and prepare and serve. Why did they do that? Because they love those outsiders and want to show them that Jesus loves them too. And so they do all that work. I'm telling you, whatever it is that you do, must be done in love. Love's what makes the difference. And you may, listen, if you're a very analytical person and you're like, okay, but why? Why is that so important? Because Jesus is our head and he is the epitome of love. Everything he did because of love. And if we're going to represent him, we have to embrace that. We have to do the same thing. We have to be like him. As his body, we must be sure love is always the motivation for what we do. And listen, I'm a pastor, but you know, sometimes I get stuck in the rut of obligation and duty and like, well, I've just got to do it. I said I would. I've got to do it. But listen, I'm missing it if I get there. You've probably been there. If you do anything, you've been there. Like, I've got to do this. I'm supposed to do it. I said I would. But when you find yourself there, just go back and say, wait, Jesus, remind me how much you loved me, because I want to do this for the right reason, because I want it to be effective. I want it to make a difference. I want it to impact lives. I want people to see your love in me. So what motivates us as a church, as the body of Christ? It's always love. It binds it all together. Now, we talked about our motivation. Let's talk about our methods for a minute. We're going to be flipping over to Ephesians chapter 4 if you want to follow. Here again, Paul's still talking about different church, but he's talking about the gifts, right? He's talking about all the ways that God's gifted his people, all the different roles to be filled in the church. And listen to what he says, same context to the Ephesians. Chapter 4, verse 11. He said, so Christ gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. And then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves, blown here and there by every wind of teaching, by the cunning and craftiness of people and their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of Him who is the head, that is Christ. From Him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Man, that's some good stuff in there. That's some good stuff in there. I almost preached the whole series from this passage. But I want you to look at the theme at work in this passage. As he talks about the body of Christ and the methods we use, he says the body of Christ must grow. He repeats that. He says the body of Christ must mature. He repeats that. And he also says the body of Christ must be built up. Now he repeats that as well. And what's it? It's all about the church becoming more and more like Jesus. It's this ongoing process of maturing, growing, being built up. So let's think about it for a minute. I'm going to break it down for just a minute. How does a church grow? Well, you know, we do this through evangelism, through sharing the gospel of Jesus with people who are outside, with people who don't know, with unbelievers, those who have not yet surrendered to Jesus and allowed Him to forgive them and to make them part of His family. And so evangelism is when we show God's love and share God's love and take the light of the truth into dark places and use every opportunity we have to let others know that Jesus loves them and be prepared to give an answer when they ask us, why would you do this? You say, well, you're talking about the gospel. What is the gospel? Well, I'm glad you asked. Here you go. The gospel is simply the good news that Jesus came to earth in love, lived the perfect life, was crucified on the cross to pay the price for your sins. He rose from the dead on the third day and now freely offers forgiveness of sin to anyone, anywhere who would receive it by faith, that they might have eternal life and a personal relationship with Him. That's the gospel. It's just that simple. And it's how we grow. It's how we bring new people in here. It's how we have infants in our midst. Let me tell you something. This isn't even in my notes, but let me tell you something. If we look around here and we see a whole room full of mature believers, we're not doing something right. Because we should be having some babies coming and joining us. We should be having some newborns becoming a part so that they can mature and grow and be built up. So I'm just telling you, man, that's part of who we are as a church. That's part of the methods we use. Now, that's how we grow. How does a church mature? We do this through discipleship. Discipleship is what happens when we grow in faith and knowledge of the Son of God. We learn more about what the Bible says, and we learn more about how to apply it to our lives. It's not just about what we know, but it's about how we live. And the more we apply it to our lives, the more mature we become. And as we mature, sin begins to have less and less of a place in our lives. We're directed more and more by God's Holy Spirit, not climbing broken trees. We believe more and more effective in our service. We become more and more like Jesus. This is all discipleship is. He took a group of people who didn't know anything about following Jesus and said, follow me, watch me, learn from me, listen to me. Now you do what I do. You go where I would go. That's what discipleship is. That's how we become mature. And that's how we love one another. We bring people in and grow and help them grow and help them become stronger and stronger in Jesus. So that's how we grow. That's how we mature. Well, how are we built up? You know what? Here's what I believe, and this is a Chad thought. I believe the church is built through our faithfulness. After we're saved and we begin to mature, the Bible says we have to hold fast to what we've learned. We don't want to be tossed around by the waves of the world. We don't want to be blown here and there by the winds of false teaching. As we mature, we want to become steadfast and dependable and reliable and faithful. And the faithful members of God's body not only fill their role, they not only do their work, but they serve as that connecting tissue that holds the body together. Those ligaments, those tendons that make the body all stick together. The faithful give the body stability. Think about this. It's the faithful givers that make sure the bills get paid. It's the faithful volunteers that make sure the programs run. It's the faithful attendees that make sure that there's a place for us to come and join together. It's the faithful that make the body strong. It's the faithful that builds the church up. So we share the gospel that people might get saved. We disciple that they might become mature. And then we are faithful so that this body becomes stronger and more effective for Jesus. And I got one last thing to share. That was our motivation. Those were our methods. But I want to talk finally about the mission. We have a mission that sends us a mandate, what we're supposed to be doing. The thing that if everything else gets left undone, this is what it means to be the body of Christ. And of course, we're going to get our mission directly from the head. I'm going to go back to a very familiar passage in Matthew, but let's read it in light of our mission as the body of Christ. Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I command you, and surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age." Jesus said, all those things we've been talking about, here's what you do. Go. Go do it. Go. Go in love. Go evangelize the lost. Go make disciples. Go faithfully to all the peoples and all nations. Everywhere the church is should be going. Everywhere the church isn't. And sometimes that looks like deepest, darkest Africa. But sometimes it looks like the break room at your workplace. And sometimes that looks like an island off the coast of Asia, and sometimes it looks like the classmates on your team at school. Everywhere the church is should be going. Everywhere the church isn't, we are to go. The bracelets became really popular there for a while, asking ourselves the question, what would Jesus do? What would Jesus do? Well, listen, we are the body of Christ. That is our mission. We must be going and doing what Jesus would be going and doing. If Jesus here lived here in a house at 600 West School Street, Brooklyn, Arkansas, you know what he would do in the morning? He would get up and he would share the good news of salvation. He would baptize people to become part of the church. He would be teaching them and growing them to become more and more like him so that they could become mature and faithful. Those are the things he would do, and those are the very things we should do. We are his body. I want to close with this thought. It's kind of silly, but it came to me this week. I thought about a guy drowning in the water, snatched up at the last minute by a lifeguard, drugged to the shore, rescued, saved. And then I thought about that guy, so weak, so in need of help. But in time, as this lifeguard nurtures him back to health, soon he's strong and says, you know what? I want to do for others what you've done for me. So he begins to train himself and prepare himself to pay it forward. He works to become a lifeguard himself so that he can jump out there and pull that next person to the shore. Listen, this is what we do. If somebody drug you to the shore and showed you the salvation that Jesus offers, then it's your responsibility. It's my responsibility to grow and to mature and to listen and to learn so that I can get strong enough to jump back out there and pull someone else in. That's why we exist. This is our mission. That's why we're here. It's why we give and volunteer and serve and teach. You are part of the body of Christ. Don't ever settle for anything less than what he's called us to be. And I ask you to bow your heads. Father, forgive us. When we forget who we are, forgive us when we forget what we do. Forgive us when we forget why we do it. We have been given the most incredible opportunity that a human could be given. The opportunity to represent Jesus to people who do not know him. God, I pray you help us. Strengthen us. Grow us. Mature us. Lead us. Help us to be the very best that we can be. Help us to have the most impact that we could have. Help us to be more effective than we've ever been. Motivate us with your love. Help us to evangelize and disciple. Help us to be faithful. And help us to go to everywhere you send us. You are the head. We are your body. Use us for your glory. We pray it in Jesus' name. And amen.
Weary.
second to sit down. Hope you grabbed a handout on the way in. It's got the wrong date on the back, but it is the one for today, October 29th. Lots of things going on. Look at the possibility of having another game night if we can get enough interest. So if you would be interested in that, let somebody know, and so we can get that scheduled and on the calendar. Also, it's the last day to get your T-shirt order in if you haven't done that. The teens next Sunday night are going to be volunteering at Together We Foster. Church van will be leaving the church at 4:30, and there'll be no teen group in the classroom that night, so have your kids here early to be a part of that. Also, again, this year, we are going to be collecting green beans to feed some families through the Brooklyn School District. We need to collect 120 cans of green beans. This has nothing to do with our Salvation Army ministry. This is a completely different Feeding the Hungry ministry. So this will be in addition to that. So we need to collect those over the next couple of weeks so we can have those in plenty of time. So if you can grab a case of green beans, bring them. The Cats group Sonic trip has been canceled because of rain. So they're going to have their party here at the church. So just bring them here at regular time, and they'll have that here tonight. And also, we're looking at having a church bonfire maybe on November 26th, so you can mark that down so that you don't miss that. And be sure to grab one of the calendars out there on the welcome station, because there's a whole lot going on, and which reminds me, this last thing I need to mention, and that is, if you didn't get a chance to fill out one of these Help Update Our Record forms, won't take you but just a minute or two, but we're going to be trying to update all of our records. And even if it's the same, like, well, you've got my stuff. Well, okay, make sure we got it, because we're trying to update everything, make sure it's all as accurate as possible. So if you would take a minute and grab one of these off the welcome station out there and fill it out and make that happen. All right, Miss Kevin.
Got a presentation from Miss Vicky's class, from the jam class.
Does Miss Shelley need to be up here, Miss Vicky?
Yeah. Oh.
Holy moly. Oh boy. Oh, thank you. Oh, thank you.
Shelley.
Shelley.
That finger.
All right.
Lead them back out that
see
case. Whoa.
Whoa.
Whoa. Whoa.
There,
there goes
the
Shelley.
Thank you.
Mr. Chad. Oh, thank you. Oh, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Give this to Chad.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Look at all these kiddos. Back in the back.
Did anybody say thank you on the kids? They practice it. Thank y'all for all the good work you do, and they know who our pastor is now. We talked about it.
So. All right. Well, cool. Talking about the pastor, that's normal, I guess.
So we know you can't do what you do without Shelley.
Amen to that.
We're a team, so we just want to spend the last Sunday thanking you two, especially. But the phrase today is, we don't want to be cheesy. You're the best.
It's a little cheesy.
So there's cheese.
Ah.
Even Henry didn't get left out.
All right.
Killian might have got left out, but Henry didn't.
He's mean. It's okay.
And there's two cheesecakes.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and then
that's awesome.
The last thing, and Chad, I hope you'll forgive me for this because I know you watch for prejudice. I would like to do a special prayer for the both of you. If you feel led to come up and circle around Chad, go ahead.
Before I do that, I can't get up here without taking the time to talk about these two. I'm going to do my best to keep it together, but today was the perfect sermon for today and for what I've been thinking about all week to say. And I talk about y'all, tell y'all all the time how much I love y'all and in this church and this group and how much better it makes me as a person. And when I think about that and I think about the body of Christ, I think about you two. And y'all have allowed God to use you as a conduit of His love to everybody in this room. And when I think about just me personally, the horrible things that I've been involved in, and you love, your love, and you've ministered to me, and you showed me how God wanted me to take something terrible in my life and use it to be better and disciple the other people and to me and be in the ministry. And my life and my family's life is better because of you two. And I don't want to speak for everybody in here, but I'm going to speak for everybody in here because when I scan the room, I know all of you personally. And I know that you've been around them long enough, and if you are here long enough, you will experience God's love through these two in some way. And I know we don't even have to hear it. You don't even have to head nod. I know that it's true. And I love you guys. And I want everybody to come up here. I want to say a prayer over them. And God's the head of our church. He is. But the Bible says that He uses people like you to be His shepherd. And we're your flock, Chad. We are. And we love you, man. We do. So,
yeah, if you felt led, come up. We're just going to circle around them. We're going to show them love.
Father, thank you for the chance to be here today. As always, we lift you up, we praise you, we thank you for all our blessings. I'd just like to take a moment, and I'd like to lift up Shelly and Chad to you this morning. And I just want to give many, many thanks for everything that you've used them to do. I hope that they know how much we love them and how much we care for them, and how much they mean to this whole community of Brooklyn, God. Without you working on Chad and Chad's heart and allowing him to do your work, there would be no Connection Point Church, God. And I just want to thank you for the many blessings and the many more blessings that you're going to do for us and use us to bless our community. Please continue to use Chad to bless our lives. Please continue to use Shelly to show the love that she shows to everyone she comes in contact with. God, I just pray that you hear us today and you lift us up. In your name I pray, amen.
Amen, amen, brother. Love.
Thank you, brother.
Thank you.
Don't make me cry.